Nancy's garden is one of many that you can visit on this year's Austin Pond Society tour. Right now, I'm excited to be joined by Steve Kainer from Hill Country Water Gardens and Nursery, one of the folks who really made pond gardening a splash in Central Texas. Steve, how are you doing?
I'm fantastic. Happy to be here.
Wonderful. We love, I'm so happy you're here because I want to talk about that because, you know, what is a water garden? When we talk about, are we talking about we need acreage to put in
Man,
a big
it could be anything from the smallest bowl that'll hold a goldfish in a plant to, yeah, of course, acres.
When did y'all first get started doing some of the garden design?
Wow, you know, this is our 25th spring, so whatever, do that math. I guess our first spring was 2000.
I'm looking at this beautiful lily over here. What plant is this?
That is actually a new cultivar. It's called Sangria.
Okay.
I think the bloom kind of explains that. It's really cool. It is it's actually a hybrid. It's a tropical hardy water lily hybrid. And it is a true true hardy water lily. It actually overwintered the last two winters in one of our big formal ponds, and it's pretty stunning.
That's beautiful. And what about in front of that? I think there's a juncus there.
There is, yeah, that's a blue dart. I love it. Yeah, it's pretty simple. Kind of what you see is what you get, but it really, I think it love how it gives structure to the pond. You can put that in a sizable pot. It'll get really, really big, really full.
Okay, and for the lily and the juncus too, and each of these, is there any specific care that you really need to do for these?
You know, that's a great question. The juncus, no.
Okay.
Very little, hardly anything. The water lily, it takes, the most important thing people can do for it is fertilize it. There is an actual tab that we use to fertilize once a month.
Okay.
Water lilies are heavy feeders. They love to eat. And if you will fertilize your water lily, especially from now until 1st of October, you'll get bigger blooms, more blooms, better hue to the flower.
Okay.
Super important.
And do you need to thin any of those out at all?
Absolutely. Once a year, you're going to repot. You're going to pull, we call them pups. They're going to have a bunch of little tubers that come off the rhizome.
Right.
And you pop those off, replant, put new soil. The soil becomes fairly anaerobic over a year. So, yeah, it needs all those things.
Okay. And what about these two right here? I see we've got a larger...
I brought a couple of taros, colocasias, wherever you want to call them. The one on the bottom, Elena, that's a new cultivar that came out about 2 or 3 years ago. It looks a lot like that taro that you see in Town Lake,
right?
Places like that. But this one's super cool. It is not a runner. It's a clumper.
Okay.
It keeps that kind of marbling, modeling to the leaf there.
Okay.
It's really pretty. And then this one, a friend of mine gave me this a couple years ago, and I've been playing with it. It's called Aloha. It is from Hawaii. It has that really cool metallic sheen to the leaf, and then with the green stem, really fun plant.
I think they're also known as elephant ears. They're worried about these being invasive. This is one that is not.
Yeah, they've done a great job of the clumper. Certainly no more invasive than any other.
Okay.
I tell people all these aquatics are made for your pond.
Right.
You know, there are certain ones, the natives, that we can plant on the side of your stock pond or something like that.
Right.
But some you don't. They're not supposed to be. No more than you should release a goldfish or a koi into the lake. It's the same thing.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what about the papyrus up
front?
Yeah,
I got a couple.
The small one and a big one.
Yeah, the little one is called dwarf papyrus. That's a little tropical. It usually doesn't overwinter here, but it's like really pretty plant. But the dwarf giant, the one with the big head on it.
Right.
It's pretty cool. It's only going to get about 2 feet tall, about what it is right now.
Okay.
But it gets the big papyrus head like a Mexican or Egyptian papyrus does.
So we've had these crazy freezes. Are some of these will overwinter and some won't?
Almost everything that we've talked about so far will. That one dwarf, probably not.
Okay.
Probably not, but the rest definitely.
Okay. And if you had that, would you need to pull that out, or is that one you just sort of just replace?
You know, even all of this, even in the worst that we've had, all of this is coming back.
Okay.
Now, if you let that pot sit outside of your pond or exposed,
where
the entire pot can freeze solid, then probably not.
And this with the white flower here, is that Sagittaria?
That is a Sagittaria. Yeah, very good. Sagittaria montedevensis. It's much like there's a native duck potato. Arrowhead sag, right?
Right.
That has a much bigger, broader leaf. This one's a little narrower and has a real pretty, that little bloom has that yellow center.
Yeah, that's
whereas
gorgeous.
Whereas native arrowhead, it's just a white bloom, but very pretty. It's a cool plant, does very well here.
Okay, and speaking of native, we then also have a native. That's the iris,
that
right?
That is a Louisiana iris, definitely native to Southeast Texas for sure. And you can put that in your pond. You could put it in a bed next to your pond. You could plant it anywhere in your gardens. Loves a little shade. And right now, it's time. You know, I love this time of year when all the iris bloom at the shop.
Yes.
And all the different colors. This is a blue. I think it's called Jerry. I'm not positive.
Okay.
But it's a cool plant. I love the iris.
Also, we're looking at this really nice lotus. Is
yeah,
that right?
this is pretty cool. I'm pretty fortunate this is here today. One, we got a lotus actually blooming that we can put on camera.
Okay.
That's neat. One of my partners just brought this to me yesterday, actually. And this is yellow peony. It's that really beautiful double. It has all the petals in it. Super cool. It's not a very big one. It's only getting about 3 feet tall, maybe.
Okay.
And the vertical leaves about that height, and the blooms about the same. I love to put these in water bowls.
Okay.
You can control them that way. They don't. The thing with lotus, you know, they're a little precocious here, but they love our temperatures right now. They love these spring temperatures. They want full sun right now, but
okay.
Man, they cannot handle July sun.
Ah.
You know, and if you put them in full sun in July, they're going to start to. Basically, just like we do, right? They shrivel up, right? Yeah, they brown out and they stress out, and they'll actually start going dormant way sooner. So you kind of put them in the sun now, and if you can pick them up and move them into the shade in the summer, they'll actually keep the leaves going. But their bloom is going to last from now until mid to late June.
Okay. Well, let's talk about the Austin Pond Society tour. It's a weekend.
Yes. Pond Society does a fantastic job. If you've never been, go. If you always go, go again. I've always enjoyed it. It's a good time. People, they're crazy about their ponds, and that's what I love about the Pond Society. They do a fantastic job of showing off water gardening. It's a really neat thing if you want something to get into.
Right, and it's for people they're going to buy tickets. What is it, $20 beforehand, $25
right.
or something like that? Okay.
I know you go to their website.
I just set the price.
They've streamlined everything now. It's so easy to go. You can
right.
buy them at each site, I believe. I think you can go to that.
And then Nancy Halls, who we saw earlier, that's one of the wonderful, many wonderful gardens
right.
you can see.
Oh, yeah, definitely do that. And that's the other cool thing. You go see their ponds, but you also get to see their gardens. You know, so many people here do such a great job with the perennials, the Central Texas perennials, in and around their gardens and ponds, so
right.
it's fantastic.
And then just a quick question. I know I've gotten this with a lot of, when we talk about wetland stuff, is there any issue if you put in water garden you're going to have with mosquitoes?
No, that's definitely a misnomer. Now, granted, you turn off your waterfall
right.
and you walk away and you leave a standing water there
right.
with no gambusia, you know, the little native fish or
right.
anything like that, absolutely, sure.
Right.
And you, of course you would.
Right.
And you know, more than you would if you left a pool of water in your yard.
Right.
But if one, they love stagnant, standing water, right?
Right.
And the goldfish and the little gambusia and all that mm-hmm. stuff in your pond, not going to be a problem.
I know the one that I have a little pond that we've done too, and I think what I've learned is if you make a habitat, you don't have that problem. And something that I think that's just amazing is not only are the fish there, which I, you know, want to ask about, are they nibbling on plants? But I mean, you know, toads, frogs show up, birds come in to use it to drink water. So, there's so much joy to get out, you know, and mine's small scale. I mean, if
right.
you set this up, it's really not just for fish. It becomes really,
absolutely.
You know,
yeah.
something for the rest of the creatures.
Yeah, it's a great habitat for
yeah.
a lot of creatures, for sure.
Yeah, and so are there any issues with fish if people decide to come? I know y'all have koi and goldfish and whatnot. Are there any issues with the fish eating the plants if you have them in there?
goldfish, not really.
Okay.
Koi, sometimes.
Okay.
Often.
Okay.
It's usually it's funny. I've seen beautiful ponds with 2 to 3 foot long koi live in perfect harmony with water lilies.
Okay.
And I have seen them just absolutely destroy them.
Okay.
So, yeah.
And then a quick thing, is there any sort of division that you need to do just in general maintenance with these? Are you pulling anything out, or once you set them in there, or they you just sort of let them go? Or
The water lilies every year, yeah.
Okay.
You're actually dividing, repotting your water lilies every
okay.
year. Most of the bogs, yeah, once they become unruly, definitely split them.
Okay. Well, Steve, I want to thank you so much for coming on. I mean, these are some beautiful plants. Really excited about the tour to see how everybody's working with these water features, because again, I think it really adds just a wonderful habitat. We need water here in Texas.
No doubt. Right.
But thank you so much, Steve, for coming on and sharing with us your breadth of knowledge on water plants and pond gardening.
My pleasure.